Here we go.
Are you ready?
Sorry. Keep up too.
Oh, sorry.
All right, let's have fun.
Hello.
Yes.
You're fired. I mean,
my life.
You thought that was good?
All right.
Watch this.
I bet that the poop that comes out of your butt is just regular poop.
We're gonna be giving you this kind of magic for another 95 days.
Ah, so cool.
Yeah. I'm gonna be a better actress.
Let's go zoom.
Oh, sorry, I thought you were talking to the camera.
Said, let's go zoomy fast.
I was like, Henry, zoomy.
What's happening?
I imagined you'd do something like this, but...
It is wrong to manipulate the feelings of friends.
Attention all Orgo sentries. That's it. I have nothing else for you. Or an Elsh.
Oh, dear.
Man.
Nico.
I'm so sorry.
Technically, we're not allowed to cook in here. I am so getting written up for this.
What a sorry. What are you doing?
Chris is over here doing Magic Mike.
Yeah.
It clashes with my eyes.
They're getting new eyeballs.
It clashes with my eyes.
Eyes.
You got eyes like a potato, it doesn't matter.
Everything on Earth, in the world, in the galaxy, clashes with those orbs.
You got eyes like a flounder. Put it on!
Leicester's flounder, look, look.
It's rocket ships. Rocket ship.
Sorry.
That's you.
Oh, I'm a chicken! You've got two dicks on your head!
Luca, look the f*** up your phone, Sergeant.
My bits and pieces were distraction. And my mother did not love...
Has everyone taken a potty break? Because I'm the only one wearing a diaper.
Mother, I'm not saying that.
Was that you using your foot to flush?
Yes!
Oh, yeah! That's me, man!
And floating.
Okay.
How are you doing today?
I'm all right.
I got this.
I can hear you giggling, James. You're killing me.
Please, can we focus?
107 day four.
Okay.
Still too.
This way to a.
Thank you.
Yes, you're welcome. I was screaming at something behind you.
Should we do a clean plate?
Dang it, I'm good at acting. I'm writing my SAG Award speech in my head right now.
In your action. Sorry.
Okay. Thanks, Lars.
Oh, yeah, he did that on purpose.
He was just trying to throw her ball.
How the
greatest citizens in the universe.
Someday, I'm gonna make great machines that fly. And me and my friends are gonna go flying together into the forever and beautiful sky.
Quill, you gotta hurry!
I look around at us, you know what I see? Losers.
When I first came on to play Peter Quill, AKA Star-Lord, the Guardians of the Galaxy were like, you know, this ragtag squad of nobodies. Everyone thought that they were scraping the bottom of the IP barrel.
Whoa! Oh my God. Quills, this is basically Gamora's.
It was sort of a lesser known comic within the Marvel world. I remember we all went to Comic-Con and showed a little footage from the first Guardians and the whole audience kind of watching it, digesting something new. That's what it felt like.
The footage we were able to show, I think people really liked it. And so I'm hoping that we can continue to make great stuff out here and that we turn out a movie that, you know, that people like, because we're all working really hard.
It was an incredibly original tone for a superhero movie.
I can't believe you had that in your purse!
It's not a purse, it's a knapsack!
Tonal shifts have been a part of this franchise from the beginning, from when we start with young Peter Quill losing his mother and screaming, crying, going out, there's a spaceship, oh my gosh, it's science fiction. And then we come to him dancing through a temple, playing and singing. So it was important for me to allow the humor and the characters to be funny.
What are you doing?
Dance off, bro. Me and you.
But it was also allowing the emotion to really play out and not be afraid of it, not be ashamed of that emotion.
I think there's more of a connection because I think the Guardians are so imperfect and their past are not squeaky clean. And they've done things that they're not super proud of, but they've tried to make up for those things. And I think that's, you know, something that everybody can relate to. There's just a true, genuine kind of family love, a chosen family love.
Doing Guardians, everybody always comes to work with the same level of excitement since day one. You know? We're rooting for each other. We are very much committed and very loyal and devoted to James' vision. And he establishes such a beautiful environment of friendship and creativity. But also passion. You know, he reminds us always about the discipline that we have to have for what we really believe in. And he really believes in this story, and he really believes in what he's creating and what he's directing.
Why would you risk your life for this?
My mother gave it to me.
The first movie is a story of the mother.
Woo-hoo! Back on the Milano. Home sweet home.
The second film is the story of the father.
He may have been your father, boy, but he wasn't your daddy. I'm damn lucky you're my boy.
And this film is a story of the self. So it's innately more intimate because of that.
Everyone around me dies, my mother, Yondu. Gamora.
I did feel like this movie is really me, you know? And Marvel was great in that they trusted me to be me, like they always have. But I pushed it a little bit further, I think.
It's really about all of these characters putting trauma behind them to become their best selves. And what James has done with Volume 3 brings everything full circle.
You know, I'm still not who you want me to be.
No, no. But who you are ain't so bad. The Guardians themselves each need to fulfill their own lives in a way that requires them to be separate from one another. So the third movie is Quill learning to be okay on his own.
My mother died in front of me when I was 8 years old, and I have been running ever since. I'm gonna need to take some time.
I think Chris is so good in the movie.
What do we know about where Rocket came from?
Nothing. He won't talk about it.
He's so emotionally raw and vulnerable. And that's one of the things I always liked about Chris Pratt was his ability to be this kind of big, charming guy, but also to be really vulnerable.
You were everything to me.
Chris is such an amazing energy to have on set. What are you doing?
Oh, let's start again, start again.
He's a perfect number one on the call sheet, meaning that person usually sets the tone and it trickles down.
Zoe's arc as Gamora is one of the most interesting arcs in the whole MCU. And her arc as Zoe Saldana through the course of the three films is also really extraordinary. She's always been fantastic. She's even more present, more focused than I've ever seen her.
She's unrelenting.
We need your hand.
And it's your choice whether it's on your body or not.
What are you doing?
She was never gonna fall for that.
I do find this Gamora very exciting, you know, because she's very independent and she's really wild.
Take six.
There's a spunk to her that, you know, Gamora never really had.
You know what? I don't care. Just drop me off with the Ravagers and you go do whatever it is that you want to do.
So her coming back is definitely thrilling.
Drax, the Destroyer.
Throughout the films, Drax has to let go of all of his anger and all of his rage.
You weren't born to be a destroyer. You were born to be a dad.
Now he's found a new love in his new family, and I think he's really just wants to enjoy life and get through life and help people along the way.
I can't imagine anyone else playing Drax. It's totally Dave. It has been Dave since the moment he walked in and he and I screen tested together. Like, everybody knew it was gonna be Dave.
Set.
Just anything, right? If we flow into the dialogue, that's fine.
Go into flow, yeah. There's
nothing wrong. I'm just gonna stand here and growl at you.
Okay.
Brr.
Yeah. Yeah.
Looks great.
He has this like quiet, calm energy resonating from this gigantic body, and there's something so interesting about that. And also James Gunn, like, laughs every single time Dave will deliver a line as Drax. You just hear him at the monitor laughing his head off.
Damn it, Mantis! Why don't you ever think?
Are we pretending to be angry again? Mantis, you asshole!
With Nebula, even from the beginning, it was clear that she wasn't just a stoic villain. She was deeply disturbed and hurt by her upbringing.
I just wanted a sister!
And now I get to explore this version of the character that is sort of healing and becoming the person that she was meant to be.
It's been beautiful to watch that transformation, but also Nebula and Karen could not be any more different from each other. And that's just a testament on how just greatly she transforms and becomes this other entity.
That's ridiculous. Do not
bring me into this.
Don't even.
Knock it off!
What?
Don't look at me like a lost puppy needing a soft place to lie down.
I didn't say anything. Totally different person. Her look, her spirit, her voice completely changes. She's bad to the bone. I mean, she is incredible.
I love you all. I do. But my whole life, I did whatever ego wanted. And then I did whatever the Guardians wanted. I need to go out and discover what I want.
This third Guardians of the Galaxy, there is much more of Mantis. And she's been around people much more too, because in the second one, she's very awkward and not really knowing what to do and how to behave. And now it's less of a softer character. You know, for me, it brings a lot of funny moments as well.
What she does with this character is so fun. And she has such a sweet innocence about her. But also, she can be a sarcastic little shit.
Welcome home, Peter.
I'm very honored that Kragwin was able to have this small role in the first movie and then expand it as an arc. And I think that that is really one of James's biggest strengths, is that there's no character that is cast aside or is just fodder. Every character fits into the construct of the whole creative piece.
Sean is a wonderful Kraglin, but also Sean really goes completely out of his way to deliver a heartfelt and strong and convincing Rocket while we're shooting that we're able to bounce off of him.
There's a whole community of people that made this great, iconic, cinematic character.
They were not looking at you funny. You got anger issues. Mature yourself!
From Bradley Cooper, who does like this unbelievable job, voicing the character and to my brother James, who writes the character, and then the whole special effects team. It's a fascinating process.
James Gunn handpicks each and every actor for each and every one of his characters.
I am Groot.
And Vin Diesel, for that matter, playing Groot, was exactly what he was envisioning.
We are Groot.
Vin is one of a kind. His voice is such a strong component to his presence.
Your natural voice.
I am Groot.
I love each and every one of these actors. It's kind of like a match made in heaven.
I looked around the other day and was just like, how did they find us all? It does feel like lightning in a bottle, actually.
It's rare to have a rapport like we have, as many years as we've put in the trenches together. Still very much a family, just like the story, really. And it's hard to even put into words. Thank you. Thank you, guys. Each and every one of you. I really mean it. You're the best fans in the world, and I'll forever be grateful.
It's our secret mission to take an imperfect clump of biological matter such as you and transform it into something perfect.
James has always had like a really soft spot for Rocket and wanting to sort of tell the story of the cruelty that happened to him as a little being, but also like how he was able to overcome so much to become, you know, the brilliant kick-ass guardian that he is today.
This is about Rocket. So this is gonna be about Rocket making the choice to do what he's never done before, which is go back for other people.
He was always very honest about the fact that if we ever got to do a third installment, that it was going to be about Rocket.
I knew that at the core of the story for me was where he came from and who he was. And it was very important for me to tell that whole story, and that was the main thing that kept me driven during the making of this movie, was telling his story. And Rocket's the one I feel close to, so this is my story. I mean, Rocket is me in so many ways. I think that, you know, the first story is the story of the mother.
Take my hand, Peter.
The second film is the story of the father.
I've searched for you for so long.
And this film is a story of the self, so it's innately more intimate because of that. We had people on set for both Rocket and Groot. My brother Sean played Rocket, and honestly, Sean was as important a member of the team as anybody else.
In the first movie, it started with me getting a phone call from my brother James saying, hey, I need somebody that I trust to read these lines, but I don't know how it's gonna work. We don't know what's gonna look like. And I just sort of showed up in London, and when we started rehearsing, it made sense for me to get in a very low crouch position and talk to the actors from there, because I knew that what the actors wanted was to look in, down and see eyes.
Oh, we're getting out. And then we're headed straight to Yondu to retrieve your bounty.
Sean's spirit really lives in Rocket. I mean, he, for years, has been doing this sort of unappreciated work of playing Rocket on set for all of us. And he's an incredible actor.
There are ships just down that hall. If we can get to one, I know, I can pilot it. And then we'll fly away together, the four of us, just like we always said, okay?
Actors don't, you know, they aren't doing monologues. They're acting off of somebody else.
I told you a million times you keep your grimy raccoon hands off my suit.
I told you a million times, I'm not a damn raccoon.
And that tennis match of acting, you need somebody else lobbying the ball back, and that's what Sean did. And then, you know, a lot of it was just the dynamics of how Rocket talked and who he was, and this angry thing that's a part of who Rocket is, and the sadness that's a part of who Rocket is. I mean, to me, that's what drives Rocket, is he's got this unrelenting loneliness and sadness. That's where his anger comes from.
Ain't no thing like me, except me.
Stitch him up and transfer him in with the rest of Batch 89.
What audiences care about more than anything else are the characters that they fall in love with, you know? And so I wanted Rocket to look like a real animal. I mean, the idea of this is that they took an innocent
little beast and turned him into something that could walk and talk and shoot a machine gun and make machines. And the little creature didn't necessarily want that. There's still a part of that little creature that is surprised that he's able to think in the way he is. You know, the comic books, sometimes Rocket gets a little too cartoony for me, and I didn't want that. I wanted him to look like a little animal that was manipulated and changed into this thing.
It blew.
That's the sky.
Sky. Rocket.
Yes, it is.
The first movie, we spent a lot of time looking at raccoons. There's a raccoon by the name of Oreo who became my pal in London, and I'd hang out with him all the time. The visual effects artists would all study Oreo, and Oreo was the basis for a lot of what Rocket is, because if we, you know, started cutting up Oreo and adding machine parts and putting in other brain elements to Oreo and turned him into a little creature that could shoot a machine gun, it would be a little bit like Rocket.
The Krabby Puppy's so cute, he makes me want to die.
Rocket has been reformulated in such a way that he's not just a raccoon. His mouth has actually been, you know, grafted and mechanically altered so that he can speak, you know, words like us. And so there are elements actually of my old dog's mouth in Rocket, because a dog's mouth is not great at speaking, but it's better at speaking than a raccoon's mouth is. So we took a lot of shots of my dog, Von Speer's mouth.
Oh, yeah.
We had a lot of voice actors audition for the role of Rocket, and they sounded like cartoon characters. We had a lot of dramatic actors come in and audition for Rocket, and they weren't funny. We had a lot of comedians come in, and they didn't seem to have the heart and grounding that the character needed. And Bradley is somebody who is able to create a character. He's able to fulfill the dramatic needs of a character. He's able to fulfill the comedic needs of a character.
Who is that maniac?
Some super douche with ray gun hands.
One of our first conversations, I remember, he said, so, like, do you want me to use my voice, or do you want me to create a character? And I'm like, no, don't use your voice. This is a character. It has to be totally separate from you.
I live for the simple things, like how much this is gonna hurt.
And he's been, you know, incredibly invested throughout this process. We watched the performance that Sean did with, you know, whatever actor it is. And then, to be honest, most of the scenes he acts with me.
Do you want to do it where you and I do it? I always feel it's better.
You got it.
I end up playing the other characters in the scene. He ends up being Rocket, and we act it in that way. And that seems to keep it more alive. It keeps more of the ping-pongy real feeling of acting.
This could be futile, Quill. I'm telling you, he's too powerful.
Well, then I guess we're going to die trying.
What is dying trying going to accomplish?
Or we could just give him the badger.
Now, our thing is dying trying.
It was a long haul for Bradley. We did many, many days. And some days we would do a whole bunch of scenes, and I would come in and decide I wanted them different. And we would go back and we would do it again. And Bradley really went with it. I mean, he was able to adjust to all sorts of stuff.
They made us for nothing. Little monsters. Stupid experiments to be thrown away.
He brings some real magic. He breathes not just his voice, but his heart into the character, and you can really feel that.
My beloved raccoon, this story has been yours all along. You just didn't know it.
I'm not a raccoon.
It means a lot to me that people respond so well to Rocket, and that Rocket is, like, such an amazing character in cinema history, I think.
Rocket, we love you very much, and we're happy you're alive.
Well, that makes you the idiot, Sid.
I always feel like I'm a slice of that. Like, there's a whole bunch of people who came together to do this. From Bradley Cooper, who does, like, this unbelievable job voicing the character, to my brother James, who writes the character, and I'm trying to translate what he's thinking about. And then the whole special effects team, which is in the middle, they're trying to get him to the place where he's 100% real on screen.
I'm done running.
I've felt grateful to be a part of it and proud of the work that we all have done in creating this character.
I was watching some of the you know, visual effects that we were putting in the other day for this movie, and it's just this gigantic sequence on Counter-Earth with this biggest spaceship ever rising up from the ocean and huge everything, explosions, people dying, all this stuff. And I said, this is the biggest movie ever made about a raccoon accepting the fact that he's a raccoon, which is really what the heart of Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 3 is at its core. It's about Rocket accepting who he is and coming to love himself and who he is as a raccoon.
You think you are more? 8, 9, P, 1, 3!
The name's Rocket. Rocket Raccoon.